Graves' disease is an autoimmune disease. It most commonly affects the thyroid, frequently causing it to enlarge to twice its size or more, become overactive, with related hypothyroid symptoms such as increased heartbeat, muscle weakness, disturbed sleep, and irritability. It can also affect the eyes, causing bulging eyes. It affects other systems of the body, including the skin, heart, circulation and nervous system. It affects up to 2% of the female population, sometimes appears after childbirth, and occurs 7 to 8 times more often in women than in men. Genetic factors are a major factor, accounting for possibly around 80% of the risk. Smoking and exposure to secondhand smoke are associated with the eye manifestations, but not the thyroid manifestations. Diagnosis is usually made on the basis of symptoms, although thyroid hormone tests may be useful, particularly to monitor treatment. It is classified as a type 2/1 cytotoxic hypersensitivity. Signs and symptoms. The signs and symptoms of Graves' disease virtually all result from the direct and indirect effects of hyperthyroidism, with main exceptions being Graves' ophthalmopathy, goiter, and prediabetic myxedema. Symptoms of the resultant hyperthyroidism are mainly insomnia, hand tremor, hyperactivity, hair loss, excessive sweating, shaking hands, itching, heat intolerance, weight loss despite increased appetite, diarrhea, frequent defecation, palpitations, muscle weakness, and skin warmth and moistness. Further signs that may be seen on physical examination are most commonly a diffusely enlarged, non-tender thyroid, lid lag, excessive lacrimation due to Graves' ophthalmopathy, arrhythmias of the heart, such as sinus tachycardia, atrial fibrillation, and premature ventricular contractions, and hypertension. People with hyperthyroidism may experience behavioral and personality changes including psychosis, mania, anxiety, agitation, and depression. Cause: thyroid-stimulating immunoglobulins recognize and bind to the thyrotropin receptor. It mimics the TSH to that receptor and activates the secretion of thyroxine and toadthyronine, and the actual TSH level will decrease in the blood plasma. The TSH levels fall because the hypothalamus-pituitary-thyroid-negative feedback loop is working. The result is very high levels of circulating thyroid hormones, and the negative feedback regulation will not work for the thyroid gland. The trigger for autoantibody production is not known. There appears to be a genetic predisposition for Graves' disease, suggesting some people are more prone than others to develop TSH receptor-activating antibodies due to a genetic cause. HLA drive appears to play a significant role. Since Graves' disease is an autoimmune disease which appears suddenly, often quite late in life, a viral or bacterial infection may trigger antibodies which cross-react with a human TSH receptor. One possible culprit is the bacterium Yersinia enterocolitica. Although indirect evidence exists for the structural similarity between the bacteria and the human thyrotropin receptor, direct causative evidence is limited. Yersinia seems not to be a major cause of this disease, although it may contribute to the development of thyroid autoimmunity arising for other reasons in genetically susceptible individuals. It has also been suggested that Yersinia enterocolitica infection is not the cause of autoimmune thyroid disease, but rather is only an associated condition, with both having a shared inherited susceptibility. More recently, the role for Yersinia enterocolitica has been disputed. Emotional stress has been posited as a possible cause of Graves' disease, as well, based largely on anecdotal evidence. While theoretical mechanisms occur by which stress could cause an aggravation of the autoimmune response that leads to Graves' disease, more robust clinical data are needed for a firm conclusion. Diagnosis: Graves' disease may present clinically with one of these characteristic signs: exophthalmos, fatigue, weight loss with increased appetite, and other symptoms of hyperthyroidism, thyrotoxicosis, rapid heartbeat, muscular weakness. Two signs are truly diagnostic of Graves' disease: exophthalmos and non-pitting edema. Goiter is an enlarged thyroid gland and is of the diffuse type. Diffuse goiter may be seen with other causes of hyperthyroidism, although Graves' disease is the most common cause of diffuse goiter. A large goiter will be visible to the naked eye, but a small goiter may be detectable only by physical examination. Occasionally, goiter is not clinically detectable, but may be seen only with CT or ultrasound examination of the thyroid. Another sign of Graves' disease is hyperthyroidism, that is, overproduction of the thyroid hormones T3 and T4. Normothyroidism is also seen, and occasionally also hyperthyroidism, which may assist in causing goiter. Hyperthyroidism in Graves' disease is confirmed, as with any other cause of hyperthyroidism, by measuring elevated blood levels of free T3 and T4. Other useful laboratory measurements in Graves' disease include thyroid-stimulating hormone and protein-bound iodine. Thyroid-stimulating antibodies may also be detected serologically. Biopsy to obtain histological testing is not normally required but may be obtained if thyroidectomy is performed. Differentiating two common forms of hyperthyroidism such as Graves' disease and toxic multinodular goiter is important to determine proper treatment. Measuring TSH receptor antibodies with the HTBI assay has been proven efficient and was the most practical approach found in one study. Eye disease. Thyroid-associated ophthalmopathy is one of the most typical symptoms of Graves' disease. It is known by a variety of terms, the most common being Graves' ophthalmopathy. Thyroid eye disease is an inflammatory condition, which affects the orbital contents including the extraocular muscles and orbital fat. It is almost always associated with Graves' disease but may rarely be seen in Hashimoto's thyroiditis, primary hyperthyroidism, or thyroid cancer. The ocular manifestations relatively specific to Graves' disease include soft tissue inflammation, proptosis, corneal exposure, and optic nerve compression. Also seen, if the patient is hyperthyroid, are more general manifestations, which are due to hyperthyroidism itself and which may be seen in any conditions that cause hyperthyroidism. These more general symptoms include lid retraction, lid lag, and a delay in the downward excursion of the upper eyelid during downward gaze. Fibroblasts in the orbital tissues may express the thyroid-stimulating hormone receptor. This may explain why one autoantibody to the TSHR can cause disease in both the thyroid and the eyes. For mild disease, artificial tears, steroids, for moderate disease, lateral tarsorrhaphy, for severe disease, orbital decompression or retroorbital radiation, classification, mnemonic, NO specs, class 0, no signs or symptoms, class 1, only signs, class 2, soft tissue involvement, class 3, proptosis, class 4, extraocular muscle involvement, class 5, corneal involvement, class 6, sight loss, pathophysiology. Graves' disease is an autoimmune disorder, in which the body produces antibodies to the receptor for thyroid-stimulating hormone. These antibodies cause hyperthyroidism because they bind to the TSHR and chronically stimulate it. The TSHR is expressed on the follicular cells of the thyroid gland, and the result of chronic stimulation is an abnormally high production of T3 and T4. This, in turn, causes the clinical symptoms of hyperthyroidism, and the enlargement of the thyroid gland visible as goiter. The infiltrative exophthalmos most frequently encountered has been explained by postulating that the thyroid gland and the extraocular muscles share a common antigen which is recognized by the antibodies. Antibodies binding to the extraocular muscles would cause swelling behind the eyeball. The orange peel skin has been explained by the infiltration of antibodies under the skin, causing an inflammatory reaction and subsequent fibrous plaques. The three types of autoantibodies to the TSH receptor currently recognized are TSI, thyroid-stimulating immunoglobulins. These antibodies act as long-acting thyroid stimulants, activating the cells in a longer and slower way than TSH, leading to an elevated production of thyroid hormone. TGI, thyroid growth immunoglobulins. These antibodies bind directly to the TSH receptor and have been implicated in the growth of thyroid follicles. TBII, thyrotrophin-binding inhibiting immunoglobulins. These antibodies inhibit the normal union of TSH with its receptor. Some will actually act as if TSH itself is binding to its receptor, thus inducing thyroid function. Other types may not stimulate the thyroid gland, but will prevent TSI and TSH from binding to and stimulating the receptor. Another effect of hyperthyroidism is bone loss from osteoporosis, caused by an increased excretion of calcium and phosphorus in the urine and stool. The effects can be minimized if the hyperthyroidism is treated early. Thyrotoxicosis can also augment calcium levels in the blood by as much as 25%. This can cause stomach upset, excessive urination, and impaired kidney function. Management. Treatment of Graves' disease includes antithyroid drugs which reduce the production of thyroid hormone, radioiodine, and thyroidectomy. As operating on a frankly hyperthyroid patient is dangerous, prior to thyroidectomy, preoperative treatment with antithyroid drugs is given to render the patient euthyroid. Treatment with antithyroid medications must be given for 6 months to 2 years to be effective. Even then, upon cessation of the drugs, the hyperthyroid state may recur. Side effects of the antithyroid medications include a potentially fatal reduction in the level of white blood cells. Therapy with radioiodine is the most common treatment in the United States, while antithyroid drugs and/or thyroidectomy are used more often in Europe, Japan, and most of the rest of the world. I2 blockers may be used to inhibit the sympathetic nervous system symptoms of tachycardia and nausea until such time as antithyroid treatments start to take effect. Pure beta blockers do not inhibit lid retraction in the eyes, which is mediated by alpha adrenergic receptors. Antithyroid drugs. The main antithyroid drugs are carbimazole, methimazole, and propylthiouracil PTU. These drugs block the binding of iodine and coupling of iodotyrosines. The most dangerous side effect is agranulocytosis. Others include granulocytopenia and aplastic anemia. Patients on these medications should see a doctor if they develop sore throat or fever. The most common side effects are rash and peripheral neuritis. These drugs also cross the placenta and are secreted in breast milk. Ligol is used to block hormone synthesis before surgery. A randomized control trial testing single-dose treatment for Graves found methimazole achieved euthyroid state more effectively after 12 weeks than did propylthiouracil. No difference in outcome was shown for adding thyroxine to antithyroid medication and continuing thyroxine versus placebo after antithyroid medication withdrawal. However, two markers were found that can help predict the risk of recurrence. These two markers are a positive TSHR antibody and smoking. A positive TSHR app at the end of antithyroid drug treatment increases the risk of recurrence to 90%. A negative TSHR app at the end of antithyroid drug treatment is associated with a 78% chance of remaining in remission. Smoking was shown to have an impact independent to a positive TSHR app. Radioiodine. Radioiodine was developed in the early 1940s at the Mallinckrodt General Clinical Research Center. This modality is suitable for most patients, although some prefer to use it mainly for older patients. Indications for radioiodine are failed medical therapy or surgery and where medical or surgical therapy are contraindicated. Hyperthyroidism may be a complication of this therapy, but may be treated with thyroid hormones if it appears. The rationale for radioactive iodine is that it accumulates in the thyroid and irradiates the gland with its beta and gamma radiations, about 90% of the total radiation being emitted by the beta particles. The most common method of iodine-131 treatment is to administer a specified amount in microcuries per gram of thyroid gland based on palpation or radiodiagnostic imaging of the gland over 24 hours. Patients who receive the therapy must be monitored regularly with thyroid blood tests to ensure they are treated with thyroid hormone before they become symptomatically hyperthyroid. For some patients, finding the correct thyroid replacement hormone and the correct dosage may take many years and may be in itself a much more difficult task than is commonly understood. Contraindications to RAI are pregnancy, ophthalmopathy, or solitary nodules. Disadvantages of this treatment are a high incidence of hyperthyroidism requiring eventual thyroid hormone supplementation in the form of a daily pill, S. The radioiodine treatment acts slowly to destroy the thyroid gland, and Graves' disease-associated hyperthyroidism is not cured in all persons by radioiodine, but has a relapse rate that depends on the dose of radioiodine which is administered. Surgery. This modality is suitable for young patients and pregnant patients. Indications are a large goiter, suspicious nodules or suspected cancer, and patients with ophthalmopathy. Both bilateral subtotal thyroidectomy and the Hartley-Dunhill procedure are possible. Advantages are immediate cure and potential removal of carcinoma. Its risks are injury of the recurrent laryngeal nerve, hypoparathyroidism, hematoma, and scarring. Removal of the gland enables complete biopsy to be performed to have definite evidence of cancer anywhere in the thyroid. No further treatment of the thyroid is required, unless cancer is detected. Radioiodine uptake study may be done after surgery, to ensure all remaining thyroid cells are destroyed. Besides this, the only remaining treatment will be levothyroxine, or thyroid replacement pills to be taken for the rest of the patient's life. Eyes. Mild cases are treated with lubricant eye drops or non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drops. Severe cases threatening vision are treated with steroids or orbital decompression. In all cases, cessation of smoking is essential. Double vision can be corrected with prism glasses and surgery. Difficulty closing eyes can be treated with lubricant gel at night, or with tape on the eyes to enable full, deep sleep. Orbital decompression can be performed to enable bulging eyes to retreat back into the head. Bone is removed from the skull behind the eyes, and space is made for the muscles and fatty tissue to fall back into the skull. Eyelid surgery can be performed on upper and or lower eyelids to reverse the effects of Graves on the eyelids. Eyelid muscles can become tight with Graves, making it impossible to close eyes all the way. Eyelid surgery involves an incision along the natural crease of the eyelid, and a scraping away of the muscle that holds the eyelid open. This makes the muscle weaker, which allows the eyelid to extend over the eyeball more effectively. Eyelid surgery helps reduce or eliminate dry eye symptoms. Prognosis: if left untreated, more serious complications could result, including birth defects in pregnancy, increased risk of a miscarriage, and in extreme cases, death. Graves' disease is often accompanied by an increase in heart rate, which may lead to further heart complications including loss of the normal heart rhythm, which may lead to stroke. If the eyes are proptotic enough that the lids do not close completely at night, dryness will occur with a risk of a secondary corneal infection which could lead to blindness. Pressure on the optic nerve behind the globe can lead to visual field defects and vision loss, as well. Epidemiology. The disease occurs most frequently in women. It occurs most often in middle age, but is not uncommon in adolescence, during pregnancy, during menopause, or in people over age 50. A marked family preponderance is seen, which has led to speculation of a genetic component. To date, no clear genetic defect has been found to point to a monogenic cause. History: Graves' disease owes its name to the Irish doctor Robert James Graves, who described a case of goiter with exophthalmos in 1835. The German Carl Adolf von Bastow independently reported the same constellation of symptoms in 1840. As a result, on the European continent, the terms Bastow's syndrome, Bastow's disease, or Morbus Bastow are more common than Graves' disease. Graves' disease has also been called exophthalmic goiter. Less commonly, it has been known as Paris disease, Begbie's disease, Flegani's disease, Flegani-Bastow syndrome, and Marsh's disease. These names for the disease were derived from Caleb Hillier Parry, James Begbie, Giuseppe Flegani, and Henry Marsh. Early reports, not widely circulated, of cases of goiter with exophthalmos were published by the Italians Giuseppe Flagina and Antonio Giuseppe Testa, in 1802 and 1810, respectively. Prior to these, Caleb Hillier Parry, a notable provincial physician in England of the late 18th century, described a case in 1786. This case was not published until 1825, but still 10 years ahead of Graves. However, fair credit for the first description of Graves' disease goes to the 12th century Persian physician Said Ismail al-Jujani, who noted the association of goiter and exophthalmos in his Thesaurus of the Shah of Khwarazm, the major medical dictionary of its time. Medical eponyms are often styled non-possessively. Thus Graves' disease and Graves' disease are variant stylings for the same term. Notable cases. George H. W. Bush, U.S. President, developed new atrial fibrillation and was diagnosed in 1991 with hyperthyroidism due to the disease and treated with radioactive iodine. The president's wife Barbara Bush also developed the disease about the same time, which in her case produced severe infiltrative exophthalmos. Missy Elliott, American musician, Marty Feldman, British comedian, Diane Finley, Canadian cabinet minister, Siah Furler, Australian singer, Rodney Dangerfield, American comedian and actor, Yano, German musician, Aoya Kaida, Japanese singer, Gail Davis, U.S. Olympic sprinter and hurdler, Barbara Lee, an American former actress and fashion model, now spokeswoman for the National Graves' Disease Foundation, Christina Rossetti, poet, author, Dame Maggie Smith, English actress. Notes. External links. Graves' disease at DMOZ.